gain. So VROP, VROP stands for Versatile Routing Platform, and it's a universal operating system platform for Huawei Datacom products. It's based on IP and adopts a component-based architecture. VROP provides rich features and functions, including application-based tailorable and extensible functions, greatly improving the running efficiency of the devices that use this operating system. To efficiently manage such devices, we mean Huawei Datacom devices, our routers, our switches, our firewalls, our access controllers, all these devices. If you are to manage them well, you need to be familiar with the versatile routing platform and versatile routing platform based configuration. So this chapter describes the basic concepts, the common commands and common command line interface and command line interface of VROP. When you complete this chapter, you should be able to understand the VROP basics, which you already understand anyway. You should learn how to use the command line interface, and you should master basic command line interface commands. First, we shall start with the overview. So we have routing devices, like routers. We have security devices, firewalls, intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems, and others. We have wireless devices like access points, access controllers. We also have switching devices like switches, layer 3 switches and layer 2 switches. All these devices run the same operating system. It is a unified system that combines all of them. So when you learn how to configure a router, you will not find a lot of difficulty configuring a firewall. A few other commands will come in because of the functions of the firewall. When you're configuring an access controller, a few new commands will come in because the access controller's function is different from a router's function. Same applies to the switch. But basically, there are some commands that are the same. In most cases, all the display commands and most basic configuration commands, device configuration commands. So VROP is a universal OS, as I've mentioned already, and it provides a number of functions, beginning from providing a unified user interface and unified management interface, to implementing the functions of the control plane and defining the interface specifications of the forwarding plane, and also implementing communication between the device forwarding plane and the VROP control plane. Now, VROP has come across different versions. We started with VROP version 1. Well, I also never saw that. Then VROP version 2. VROP version 2 came out around in around 1999 and 2000, around there. And then from VROP version 3, we went on to VROP, VROP version 3, which was around 2000 to 2004. And then we went ahead to VROP version 5. I don't know what happened to version 4, but we went to VROP version 5, which most of our devices are still using now. Now, most of our high-end devices are already using the new VROP version, VROP version 8. So we have some NE series routers and some CE series switches. These are heavy-duty routers and heavy-duty switches, core-level routers and switches. They run VROP version 8, which came in from 2009 and is still working up to now. Now, VROP 5 came in from around 2004, and we are still using it. Actually, what we are using in ENSP in this class is VROP version 5. Yeah, these are the versions. Each version has some unique characteristics, as illustrated in that slide. So VROP has a file system that manages files and directories in storage media, allowing users to view, create, rename, and delete directories, and copy, move, rename, and delete files. Now, mastering the basic operations of the file system is crucial for network engineers to efficiently manage configuration files and VROP system files of devices. We have mainly four types of files that VROP handles. We have the .cc file, the .cfg file, the .pat, and the .bin. These are the four kinds of files you'll find in most of our devices. and the .cfg sometimes .zip or .dat. Now, this one will in most cases be a configuration file. When you configure your device and save the configurations, they are going to be saved in the .cfg or .zip or .dat. Most commonly .cfg. Now, system software files like the VRP image, like your, take the analogy of your Windows disk image. So the VRP image is a .cc file, which is a startup software, and then a patch file that is used to fix bugs in system software normally has the extension .pat, and then we also have the path file that controls the features and resources, which is a .bin file. Now, all those files need to be stored in some kind of medium, and VRP, our devices support five particular storages: the SDRAM, the flash memory, the NVRAM, the SD card, and the USB. So the SDRAM is a synchronous dynamic RAM, which is like a computer's RAM, stores the system running information and parameters. Flash is non-volatile. Non-volatile means that when power goes off, the contents in flash memory remain there. It is used to store system software, configuration files, and other information. Patch files and path files are uploaded by maintenance personnel and generally stored in flash memory or the SD card. SD card avoids data loss in data. Avoids data loss in case of power off. The SD card has a large storage capacity and is generally installed on the main control board. It is used to store system files, configuration files, log files, and other stuff. USB is normally just attached, and then non-volatile RAM is like RAM, SDRAM, but it's non-volatile. Now, the purpose of non-volatile RAM in most cases is for the log. Log is like a record of what is happening to the device. And sometimes while these devices are forwarding our data, the log can become a very huge file. The log buffer can become a very huge file. And if it's stored in RAM, this can slow down the machine because RAM is normally limited. So we have non-volatile RAM to handle that for us. Those are the five kinds of storage that most of our devices support. For our device to initialize, when we power it on, it runs the boot ROM, the boot read-only memory software, to initialize the hardware and display hardware parameters. After that, it runs system software, which is the VRP, and reads the configuration file from default storage path to perform initialization, something like that. Loads the VRP image, which is a .cc, and then loads the configuration file .cfg that is stored somewhere in the device to load the initial configurations that were saved onto the devices. Are we together?
Yes.
Well, now to manage all these things that we have talked about so far, we use two main modes. We can either use the command line interface, or we can use the web system, or the web user interface, the graphical user interface. Unfortunately, for the routers and switches we are going to use in this class, we don't have access to the web unless you have a physical device. All right, to use the device management mode, you must first log into the device through a login mode supported by the device management. We have the web system and the CLI, as I've explained. Now, for the web system, you can go HTTP, you can also go the secure HTTP. But you should note that there are functions that cannot be performed in the web system, can only be performed in the CLI. So CLI has more superior functionality. And also it supports the console port, telnet, and SSH logins. Console, if you have physical access to the device, you'll connect to the console port using a console cable, rollover cable. And if you're connecting remotely, or you're using the service interfaces, the service ports of the device, then you're either going to use Telnet or use SSH. Now, Telnet is very insecure, and we always advise people to use SSH that supports encryption. Now, VRP also has user interfaces. When you log into a device through command line interface supported mode, the system allocates a user interface to manage and monitor the current session. Now, user interfaces can either be the console user interface or the virtual teletype terminal user interface. I've already mentioned that console user interface, you need to be physically attached to the device. It is used to manage and monitor the users who log into a device through a console port, and the serial port of a user terminal is the one that is connected directly to the console port of the device for local access. Now, for virtual teletype terminal, you're using remote access to use Telnet or STLnet, secure Telnet. The V2I user interface is used to manage and monitor users who log into a device by means of the virtual teletype terminal. After a Telnet or STLnet, think of it as SSH, connection is established between a user terminal and a device, a V2I channel is established to implement remote access to the device. Now, whether you're using console or you're using V2I interfaces, there are particular user levels that you need to understand, four different levels: the visit level, the monitoring level, the configuration level, and the management level. At the visit level, you can basically perform network diagnostics commands, ping, trace route, and view certain things, but very, very few display commands will run at the visitor level, because you are just a visitor. You're not exactly part of the people who are supposed to see what is going on. Now, we have the monitoring level, where you have access to system maintenance commands, including most of the display commands. You want to see what is running in the system. You want to report what happened in the system, or to record the logs. Most display commands are all accessible at the monitoring level. Now, above the monitoring level, you have the configuration level. The configuration level is where you can do service configuration commands. If you want to configure routing, if you want to configure IP addresses, you want to provide users with network services, you need to have the powers of the configuration of this user level in order to access the command levels. And then the management level is the highest, command level 0, 1, 2, and 3. That includes commands for controlling basic system operations and providing support for services, including the file system, file transfer protocol, TFTP download, user management, and command level commands. So at this level, you can also assign other commands to other levels, depending on what you want, because you are a management level user. So our users can have privilege levels 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 15. Now, different privilege levels are assigned different command levels. From privilege level 3 up to 15, they have all the command levels 0, 1, 2, and 3. For privilege level 2, you can only access command levels, commands that are in command level 0 or 1 or 2. And then in privilege level 1, you can only access command levels of visitors and monitors. I hope this makes sense. Anyone there?
Yes, it does.
All right. So to log into the web interface, you basically need to connect your device to your network device like that. Connect your device like laptop or PC to the network device and make sure there is reachability between the two, and then access the device over the web browser. It will open the device interface. Again, don't try this in ENSP, it will not work. And then for command line interface access, you can use local, where you're physically connected to the device. In that case, you'll be connected to the console port of the device. You get your PC COM port and connect it over using rollover cable or console cable to the console port of the device, which is normally RJ45 to DB9. The cable looks like this. It's a DB9 port on one side and RJ45 port on the other side. So the RJ45 goes into the network device, router or switch or firewall, whichever it is, and then the DB9 port goes to the COM port of your computer. But very few computers have a COM port these days, serial interface. So what we do, we normally use adapters, okay? We use adapters, it has a DB9 on one end and USB on the other end. So we attach the adapter to this cable and then plug the USB into our laptop to be able to do the configurations. That is if you want to use local login. After making the connections, you'll open a terminal emulator on your computer like PuTTY. So when you open the terminal emulator, in this case, we are using PuTTY's screenshot. It will have a lot of information. You need to enter. You need to select serial here and then make sure it is the COM port you're connected to that is selected here. If that's all true, if that's all true, then you will just click open and you'll be taken to the next interface. For remote login, you're going to use either SSH or Telnet, and then you enter the IP address. If you select SSH, it will put 22 there. If you select Telnet, it will put 23 there. And then you enter the IP address and hit open, and it will load you into the device. It will take you to this. Either way, whether you use this mode or you use the remote, you'll end up with a screen where you can enter commands to configure your device. So which commands are we talking about? We need to understand the command line overview to know which commands you're talking about now. Any questions so far? So our commands basically have a command word. I think it's, yeah. Yeah, our commands basically have a command word, a keyword, and then the parameter list. The parameters are normally parameter name and parameter. Are we together? All right.
Yeah.
So, our commands have a very clear structure, and it looks like this. We have a number of views. We have the user view. The user view is going to be the very first view when you open the command line interface, and you know you're in the user view if you have that kind of brackets around the prompt. This type of prompt is for the user view. And then when you have that type of prompt, well, things start being complicated because generally it is going to be the system view, but each of these other views also that you can access from the system view have this kind of square brackets. So we have the user view, we have the system view, we have interface views, different interface views, gigabit Ethernet interface views, Ethernet interface views, serial interface views, and so on. And then we have protocol views like OSPF view, ISIS view, BGP view. Now, some protocols also have other views, like in OSPF, you have the OSPF area view. But basically, this is how our commands are organized. So depending on where you are, if you are at the user view, you can type the command system view to get into the system view. And if you are at the system view, you can type the command quit to get back to the user view. Now, if you are at the system view, you can type the command interface gigabit Ethernet 0/0/1 to get into interface view of gigabit Ethernet 0/0/1. And you can type the command, for example, OSPF1 to get into the protocol view of OSPF. From the protocol view of OSPF, you can use the command quit to get back to the system view. Also from the interface view, you can use the command quit to get back to the system view. So basically, you use the command quit every time you want to move back one step, move your view one step back. So quit from interface view back to system view, quit from protocol view back to system view, quit from system view back to user view, from user view to system view, moving up there are different commands, moving down it's the same command. Now sometimes you're in some view deep in there and you want to go back all the way to the user view, you're going to use return or you're going to type control and Z on your keyboard. It will take you back straight to the user view. Are we together?
Yes.
Yeah, now most of these things are going to become a lot more clear when we when you actually do the exercises, the lab exercises. There's going to be a lab guide I'm going to upload today to the channel for you guys to use for to try out those labs. Any question? All right, these are just different ways to navigate the command line interface. Command line help, you can use the question mark to see a list of commands that can be used at a particular view. And you can also have partial help. You know part of the command, but you don't know how it ends. You know it starts with D, but you don't know what comes after. You can type D and question mark, and then it will complete. Now, most importantly, for me in this class, is this error messages. Normally, when the command line is showing you error messages, it uses this. And it's going to position it at a point where it gets lost at. For example, in this example here, it is showing incomplete command found at that. That means that a supplement needs to be made at the position of the arrow. If it says incomplete command, it means there is something that needs to be added to what you've typed. Sysname is a command that we use to change the name of the device. So if you type sysname and leave it alone, the device needs to know which name, which is the new name you want. So it's going to put an arrow there to tell you that there is a problem and you need to solve it. And then it tells you unrecognized command. It means, by the way, it does not exactly mean the command is not recognized. It means the command is not recognized at the view where you've typed it. That's important. Okay. And then when you see ambiguous command, it means there is more than one command that match what you've typed. If you type A and press enter, it tells that's an ambiguous command. I have a lot of commands that have that A. So do you want this one or this one or this one? It's ambiguous. I don't get what you mean. Are we together?
Yes.
Yeah, and then we have parameter, wrong parameter found at that value. It means you're using the wrong parameter. Now, we have a few slides here that have a few usages of those commands. I'm not going to explain these ones. You will have them in your material and you can go through them slowly by slowly. And then we have some basic configuration commands. PWD displays for you the current working, working directory, and DIR shows you the contents or the information about files in the current directory. And then more displays the contents of a text file. Say more and something displays the contents of a text file. There are several commands that we have here. Remove directory, copy, move, rename, delete, undelete. And let me talk about delete and undelete. So delete is sending something to the recycle bin. Undelete is removing something from the recycle bin. Reset recycle bin is to remove something from the recycle bin. Undelete is bring back something that we had deleted. Excuse me about that. So you can delete something, goes to the recycle bin. When you say undelete, comes back from the recycle bin to wherever it was. Now reset the recycle bin, deletes whatever is in the recycle bin. If you want to delete something and it doesn't go to the recycle bin, you're going to want to use the command delete and reserve. Delete and reserve. And then the file name will remove it and it will not store it in the recycle bin. All right, so these are the commands in use, sysname, and you specify name, clock, time zone. Now for these commands, you will set up some kind of lab and try them out from the notes. They are all very clear. You can always use them anytime rather than going through them here. There is actually a case for you to work out. This will be in your notes, so you can find them in your notes and practice accordingly. The different commands are used here, and sample output that will be shown if you use them in your ENSP is also shown. File operation commands like rename, like copy, they are all here. And then move file, changing directory to some other directory, deleting a file, undeleting a file. And then we also have another case. Actually, this one, I would want to see it. For those of you who will do it, please send me your result as a saved file of ENSP on Telegram. It's the same thing. Everything has been explained. All the procedures have been explained of what you need to do. You just need to go follow along and complete and save.